Good day, folks. This is Shane Hasty. I'm the lead editor for Culture and Methods at InfoQ.com, and this is the Culture and Methods Trend Report for 2021. We thought we'd explore a slightly different way of doing it this year. I've invited my colleagues, the editorial team from the Culture and Methods area at InfoQ, to discuss what we have seen over the last year. I'm privileged to be joined by Craig Smith, Douglas Talbot, Ben Linders, and Raf Gamel. Unfortunately, our colleague Sharon Alvarez was not able to join us, but she sends her best regards to all of us and to all of our audience. Team, thank you all for joining us today. Let's just do a quick round robin. I'm sure many of our listeners have read your content, but haven't probably heard your voices all that often. So Craig, welcome. Tell us who's Craig.
Hey Shane, yes, I'm Craig Smith from Australia. I can't remember how long I've been around InfoQ, but it's a long time, and bring the perspective of agility and culture and methods from this side of the world.
Welcome. And Douglas.
Hi, Douglas, or Doug Talbot. I'm currently in New Zealand. I've just moved back from 8 years in Europe, where I got to see many of the differences between running teams in different cultures across the European continent. And it's really interesting being back in New Zealand and comparing the two. My passion has very much been organizational dynamics and how team dynamics and bits and pieces of organizations interact with each other. And I've recently put out a couple of articles on product thinking, but I guess my other big passion is leadership.
And Ben.
Ben Linders, based in the Netherlands, very happy to be writing for InfoQ, started in 2012, and still being impressed and surprised by all the stuff that's happening in the culture and metasphere. Mostly focusing these days on the leadership stuff, culture change, and trying to get case studies, practical stories from people doing agile in the world, getting those stories out on InfoQ.
And Raf.
Hi, I'm another Kiwi, so I'm also in New Zealand. I've been writing for InfoQ since about 2012. A good friend of mine, Catherine Kirk, who was doing the Agile stream at QCon at the time, brought me in. We did a talk together, and it led one thing to another. And the funny story is, I was put in touch with Shane, and Shane was my lead editor. And I'm like, all right, whereabouts in the world are you? And we just moved to New Zealand. And it turned out Shane lives 10 minutes away from me. My passions are here, engineering, applying Agile engineering techniques, XP methodologies, which I still think have a lot of value. I've been coaching agile teams, coaching technical teams within the technical practices. And it's led me through a journey to teaching. Currently, I'm a head of product with a company in the education space. I think that's going to connect with the conversation today, because I see a big, sharp rise in how we value education, how we do education, how those educational skills apply to us as coaches as well. So big on that. Team topologies is the other passion point for me at the moment. It's something which I'm throwing out in just about every other conversation, because I see it as an answer to why Conway's law works, a good way of justifying that when you're having those conversations.
Thank you. Welcome. And I can say that Sharon is on the West Coast, USA. So we're not all based in the Southern Hemisphere. In the virtual world that we live in today, physical location doesn't make a big difference. And that, I think, is a nice segue into talking about what we've seen over the last year. Obviously, the impact of COVID-19 has been huge in the culture and method space and huge on the world in general. But gents, what does that really mean to us looking at the trends in culture and methods for InfoQ, for our audience?
Let me jump in on that one. What I've seen is that a lot of teams have been forced to go remotely, to start working remotely since they're not able to come over to the office. And they're basically mimicking the stuff that they've been doing on being on site remotely. And I think what you can see is a huge difference in there on whether these people are already capable of collaborating in a different way when they are working remotely in there. I see organizations who are having meeting after meeting, working remotely, really wearing people out there, and people being exhausted already halfway the day and then having to work another 4 hours to do it. Where I see other organizations that have really managed to set up a way that where people can work remotely, but also can work asynchronously and can work at their own pace and bring in their own knowledge and their own experience in a way and at a time that suits them well. And I think this is making a big difference in those companies where people are able to do that.
I think coupled with that is the digital transformation that organizations have had to endure. So organizations that might have been holding off on that were forced to go down that path. So not only have the workers themselves been forced to work differently, obviously, as customers, there's the forced work differently, and then as the services we give to our customers. So it's forced a lot of the methods in relation to thinking about service design and product design and putting those things and applying them in a different way has meant that a lot of things that, you know, perhaps some organizations had a lead on, everybody kind of had to, you know, fall into the same field.
So, Raf, you were going to say something.
Along similar lines, I mean, I saw the same at the very start of the pandemic, which was the attempt to apply the physical workspace metaphor to the remote workspace. And it wasn't work. It was attempts to have too many meetings, as you said. It was misuse of whiteboarding tools. It was trying to figure out how to facilitate things, how to collaborate as a team. The big Slack with too many people, going back to the team topologies thing, has a good piece of advice, which is don't do that. Have clear groups where people actually do need to interact communicate. As you point out, Craig, I then saw this need for people to figure out how to use their tools well. Rapid experimentation, figuring out which are the right tools. Do we use the Miros? Do we use the Jamboards? Do we use something else? How do we do remote trust gathering sessions? How do we do that remote drink and make it effective? Companies which were on-premise starting to move more readily to the cloud and trying to make that happen. There's definitely been this acceleration in what we're doing, how we do it. And the remote work thing's also been an interesting balancing act I've seen, because I was remote working the prior year and there was a lot of asynchronous. But then in post-COVID, the company I was with at that stage went straight into remote first. And there were questions about what that meant. There was still the notion of the 9-to-5 day coming to terms with actually it's probably better to give people space in their day has been a journey through the year. I'm remote teaching. The institution I was with, I probably wouldn't have joined it a year ago, but now I'm building a product which is a remote first product. They had an on-site office in Whangarei and their students are doing really well. It's bringing in people who don't have the freedom to study during the working day. People are able to live and balance their lives slightly better. So there's this emergent effect coming out of it, which perhaps is better quality of life, which feels strange saying that in this situation where COVID is taking so many lives.
I would like to say, though, that the way we've sort of painted it there has been quite rosy and positive, that it's all been steps forward. But I think that's definitely not true of many organizations. Yes, we can point out exemplars who are handling remote very well, but we're also seeing people getting into this scenario where life is mixed with work and you can't differentiate where the two boundaries are, and work carries on the whole day and people never escape it because all of their gadgets are their work life and their personal life now. We're also seeing large groups that might have come together and done anything from iteration planning or workshops together really struggling to come together and interact in a remote world because everyone's a little dot on a screen and you have to wait turns and such like. So the interplay and the random conversations and the washing machine effect amongst people is now being lost. We're not seeing that kind of same brainstorm and collaboration effect. And yes, we're trying to simulate and find ways around those, but in my opinion, they haven't reached the same height as we were getting out of that face-to-face work. And as new people come in, they really struggle to socially integrate into the workplace. They're really struggling to get a water cooler conversation or a coffee or go to the pub. And so all of those elements are getting lost. So I do think that there's a lot of growth to go on in this place and finding a happy medium between a remote-only style organization, which I'm not really a believer in at the moment, and some kind of balance or the forced aspect of COVID is going to take us a lot longer, I think.
I wonder when you say that, because I kind of had similar doubts as I was seeing this in the company I was with at the time going through the journey. And there's a thing in my head, which is that their outputs, their behaviors we want to see in the on-site teams that we see. We trust collaboration first. I don't think this would have happened 10 years ago when the tech was not as good. But if we focus on those outputs, you know, how do we build that trust? How do we get the output from that collaboration session? We're able to facilitate those outcomes in the remote setting. And I think it does take effort. We're going through the learning period now, but I think it is achievable. And I think at the end of that journey, I mean, there's a personal bias here. I love remote. But I think at the end of that journey, there is an alternate paradigm for how we work. And there's a better work-life balance. And people will be going through that. And maybe that's part of why we're here. We've got this curve. We've got the innovators and we've got the early adopters. And there's some people who are going to have an advantage because they'd started there and they have a bit of a bias and they've seen the GitLabs and how they're working out there and they may have done it themselves. And then you've got people who are this early majority, the late majority, and the term being thrown around a lot right now is hybrid working. This mix between in the office, remote, And I can see people are still kind of holding on to that. And I hear people wanting to hold on to the workplace. And my experience with the hybrid model when it was starting was it was actually really bad because there was this disparity between people in the office and people remote. It broke the communication. And I think it was one of the new spaces I did on a company in Cornwall. And they were looking at how they could use their on-site time better towards trust building and such. So I hear what you're saying. I'm hopeful and optimistic towards a good outcome, but I think we can lead the way and we can coach the right behaviors.
Craig, you have something to say on this.
I think it's also bringing out some of the worst, though. So as we start to hit, well, I guess we're calling it the new normal or whatever it might be, but now we've sort of been dealing with this for over a year. The amount of organizations now that are coming out with these forced hybrid models, so you must be one day or two day in the office, which also then for every organization like Spotify or Facebook that might come out and say, you can work remotely forever. It's putting an interesting spin now on how organizations actually treat their employees and the culture that is behind them. And I think what's been interesting is we think about, for a lot of us, we're agile coaches on this journey. The difference between trying to do things like support organizations on their journey when the only thing you can see is through a Zoom window. I was speaking to people early on in the pandemic and they're going, yeah, this has worked fine. We just kind of picked everything up and we just put it behind a bunch of electronic stuff and we put everything on an electronic whiteboard and away we went. And I think that was fine because we all had this connection that we knew how everybody worked in the office and it was just instead of you sitting three chairs from me, I was just seeing you in a Zoom window. What I've found interesting is then as I've started to work with organizations or teams that have formed post this, that a lot of those cultural norms, the effort that we might have often put in to get people together, to learn each other's differences and how we might work together has changed. And it's shown the divide a little bit between organizations that have embraced this way of working versus those that perhaps are trying to pull back to that old style of working.
So what I'm definitely hearing here is there is good remote and there's bad remote. And we've seen examples, we've seen situations of both. So if we think of our technology adoption curve, I'm going to say that probably over on the left in the innovators, early adopters are people who are doing good remote. My guess is the majority are really struggling with that. What advice would we have to what makes that good remote?
I think it's the famous story of not having one size fits all in there, which is really important in there. I work with people all around the world on the work that I do from my own company and also on the writing that I do with InfoQ. And there's very different ways that I work with people based on what's their experience, based on the way that I would like to do their work in there. I think what's given me a benefit in there is the flexibility to adapt to somebody else's style and to find a way that's working for us in there. And I think the other that's given me a big advantage in there that I basically start from assuming that the person I'm connecting with, that I'm starting to work with, wants to do a good job and wants to go towards a good result the best way they can. And then we try to find a solution to get there. And starting from trust and starting from that relationship can get you a long way in there. So I think that's a key issue which denominates what's good in a certain situation from what's not working.
You're connecting with the conversation I had last night. So Catherine, who I mentioned earlier, Catherine Kirk, she does a lot of talks in the politics space, but she's got this little group and there's a book coming out at some stage, but she has these models that a bunch of us try and share and apply in the workplace, which are kind of lenses to see what's going on in an interaction. I use them a lot in the remote space. It's like trying to see where the other person is coming from. What is the context? You see the pain, the struggling, someone who's having trouble there. And yeah, things like check-in protocol may be examples of this. Understand where they're coming from. But also lenses, like what are the tensions in this context? Is this person working from home in their kitchen with other stuff going on? Is this person someone who's been in back-to-back meetings for the last 4 hours and needs that Zoom fatigue? And it's then being able to call, should we just do this later? That empathy kind of plays a bit because we're not in the office sharing each other's day, trying to understand the context. This person's on 3 projects and can I go and co-discover with them what it is that they haven't done? Can I look at their current, backlog and just feel if I'm adding more pressure? I don't know. There's this thing I'm kind of slightly more aware of, which is building some context, which may be me spending more effort. But yeah, there are these lenses, the realities, this notion that order falls into disorder just because someone is there last week and everything seems to be running smoothly. Be aware that human context is changing. It's all to do with entropy and change. And kind of just be aware of that because I don't have the continuous real-time cues. It is about building a compassion when you're in those conversations and in those moments.
Quite a lot of research and work in looking at the psychology of this and trying to come up early on when we were covering a lot of the COVID stuff. So what are some of the things that you found?
I did a few articles with Dr. Michelle O'Sullivan. She's a clinical psychologist that I got to know in the UK, and we were talking about mental health in those articles. And I think that we're still seeing mental health is a key aspect of this whole process. Now, because that tangible human interaction has vanished, particularly in Europe and other countries around the world, New Zealand is incredibly privileged in this space at the moment. Because that physical interaction has disappeared, we've got to be far, far more aware of the human interactions in our organization, and we have to make time for them. And that means if you're doing some form of leadership in your organization, then you now need to think about, how am I going to have my tribe of 150 people interact, socialize, connect, get to know each other so that trust can be there and empathy can be there and spotting when someone's having a bad day can be there, which you might have picked up body language before, but now you're only maybe seeing someone in the corner of a remote Zoom window and going, are they acting differently? Should I ask a question? How do I get that one-to-one with them to ask that question now as a leader? All of those things have become much more essential to dedicate specific structured time to achieve. And we just used to have it almost happen by accident on a walk the floor or at the water cooler. I think the good remote is where there is focused attention on the human interaction in your organization. The bad remote is often where they haven't made a structured attempt to build that into stuff that's now very process driven.
Thank you. And I know we could continue talking about this one for quite a long time because we're all pretty passionate. But if we think of our trends report and the technology adoption curve, I think we could say at this point that there is the good remote, there is the bad remote, and there are some ideas to help move those good remote practices into more organizations that we hope. So what are the other things? And Craig, you touched on the digital transformation and the acceleration of that. What does that mean to our audience?
Well, it means as customers, what we might expect from our organization, things that we've been talking about for a long time on InfoQ, things like Conway's Law and the way we see an organization is a lot more exposed. There's a lot of work. And I know, Raf, you've got a lot of passion around, you know, team topologies and those type of topics. That's become ever more important because the way we build, the way we collaborate is what now starts to expose itself to the outside world. And similarly, when we come back onto the inside of the organization, the fact that we've all been forced to be cloud first. We're recording this podcast in a cloud-based format using cloud-based tools. We mentioned things like being forced to use tools like Miro and ALMs. DevOps is in some ways forcing itself on top of us. But what it's now doing is starting to really be a bit of a forcing function to where are some of those roadblocks or alerts inside our organizations of things where we haven't quite perhaps grown up or gone as fast as we need to as we try to compete in this new world.
There's a connection to that. You talk about the alerts, and the alerts implies observability and monitoring. I've seen that there's more automation, which leads to more understanding of what's happening in our products. And we're getting deeper insights, and those insights I'm seeing are leading to questioning how we can get a deeper understanding of that data. So there's a connection from there to things like using AI models to get a deeper understanding of how your products are being used, how different metrics cross-correlate, being able to bring those back into product decisions. I mean, we're already moving there. We were doing multivariate testing and all sorts of things. But I'm seeing the whole flow, the whole value stream result in more data. And having more data across the value stream means you can look at those early engagements from HubSpot in marketing, and you can cross-correlate them with sales output and with quality and mean time to failure in the middle. And all of those metrics are there to be exploited a bit more.
I think that the tools are there, and certainly AI looks very promising in there as a way to dig into this data and to really get these insights in there. But I think it only starts in companies who are really curious enough to find out how the products are being used and are really being interested in having the culture in there to learn about this stuff in there and are really asking the right questions and are willing to ask the right questions to get this kind of understanding in there. I still see myself struggling with a lot of digital products where I'm really thinking like, okay, I made this mistake 5 or 6 times already. It should be easy to dig out that there's a mistake in here, a design mistake in there, and I'm probably not the only customer bumping against that. But if they're not looking for that insight, if they're not asking that question, if they're not looking to dig out that kind of information from the data, they're not getting it. So the tools are there, but it also needs the culture and the drive and the people to find out to really get the benefits out of this.
It's very true. You can have the data, but you have to ask the right questions of the data. And maybe our questions are still biased by traditional models. Is the product doing well? I'm still talking about failures. I'm sure there are deeper insights. There's a tool, Pluralsight Flow. It's this thing that gives development teams deeper insights into how their developers are developing things like automated heat maps of where technical debt is. If you're working on an issue, how much of your issue is debt? And that's digging in for insights that you can then use to prioritize where you put your technical debt. And tools like that are becoming more prominent. I don't know if they're connected with remote and the COVID, but asking the question is hard.
So last year in the innovators space, we did identify AI and ML tooling. What I'm hearing, and I'm certainly seeing some articles on socio-technical systems and on AI systems as teammates, what I'm seeing is that that is coming forward. Is it enough that you would say it's moved from the innovator to earlier adopter, or are these things that are only being used in the innovator space at the moment?
My impression would be that it's still innovators, it's still rarely used in there, and all these kind of users are more or less individual users, individual cases, one company using it in one certain way, and there's no shared learning yet in this area. I'm hoping that we can drive this on InfoQ. I tried to publish a couple of articles in there on companies that are using AI in their processes. And I'm hoping that other companies are picking up on that and building on top of those ideas to experiment and to do their own ideas. But I don't see that happening yet. It's all individual, isolated cases right now.
I think we need to be careful to distinguish between true ML and AI models and just technologically enabled measurement. We're seeing a lot of the digital transformation bit that Craig brought up, where we're being forced to now use tools to measure remotely distributed actions across our organization. And suddenly we've seen this even more burgeoning of these kind of culture, I guess, engagement checking tools where they poll the organization every day with a question and stuff. But no one's really intelligently using that data and really understanding what it means. And because it's highly complex data with huge numbers of moving variables and definitely way out on the complex space in the Kinevan kind of grid, then I think at the moment we're just almost spamming ourselves with data and not really knowing what to do with it or using it really badly in our organizations. And then we cross from that into, well, how can we really use the ML kind of tricks that they're using, for instance, in cybersecurity, where they're getting algorithms to really learn the patterns of attack and spot them and turn them off before any human could have ever intervened. We're definitely not applying that kind of level of learning to our people and culture space at the moment. So that's really early innovator for me. And I'm worried that I'm not seeing anyone using the kind of digital transformation pieces in that space really intelligently. So that's definitely an innovator space.
Yeah, I agree. For culture and application in this domain, we're still figuring out how to use that data. I've seen application of models that provide insights into people, how they behave and such, and conversations about how do we use this. We know who our customers are, but how do we use this? We know things about them. We have classifications, but we're still at that stage where we're like, wow, shiny magic insight. But yeah, as you said, Ben, what is the question? What is the question this is answering? You kind of have to retrofit the question to the answer.
Even the accelerate measures like the mean time to failure and stuff that have become really popular and got really obsessed by our engineering types, they're a very fragment of a value stream. They're not actually telling us whether or not our value stream got better or we got more productive as an organization. They're very much an isolated element just looking at software. And I think that that's a mistake to start narrowing to that space.
You can cross-correlate, though. As I was saying, you can look at your marketing data. So I've done that sort of thing. With Splunk, if you've got the data, it comes back to the question, what does it look like if I plot my marketing data with my product data and I can see how they cross-correlate? I can correlate it with my release events and there are levels of insight there. So I think there is data there, but the question isn't always obvious. But what I would say is that we're in a place where we're collecting more data than before. We value data. We know that every event is valuable. We have been throwing away a lot of information for a long time, and we're moving to a place where we can stick them in a data lake. I can stick them in S3 bucket and build, you know, a data lake out of it and then analyze it later. How much of it gets used? How much of it is valuable? I don't know if there's a rule for that yet.
And I think part of this is for organizations, the smart ones are able to take that data. But what I'm seeing in a lot of organizations is that we still treat data as a separate silo or department. And so now there's this channel, because we haven't culturally probably built data in as being data first as part of our teams. I mean, you go back and read the XP books and they talk about the tester and the developer and the analyst, but there's no mention of the data analyst or data engineer that we might need in order to make sense of all that. So what I am now seeing in organizations is this queue now of people coming towards their data or their BI departments because they need this type of thing. But a lot of our engineers don't have that experience in there, and it becomes now a throttle for organizations. So we're collecting all this data, but we now need to get better in the way we culturally start to integrate that into our engineering processes.
So we're talking about, we've got all of this data, we can access all of this data, we can use all of this data. I want to throw up the question, should we? One of the topics we've been exploring on InfoQ for the last couple of years is ethics. How are we doing in terms of technology for good and ethical behavior in our industry? Where are we headed? What's happening?
It's there. It's definitely there. And I see more and more companies becoming visible that are actually doing it, not just like picking it up, but companies who've been doing this for years and are looking at tech for good and looking at, okay, why are we running this company? And our goal is not to make money for our stakeholders, but we've got a different goal in there. So I think the challenge that we have as InfoQ editors in there is to show this to the world that it's actually possible because companies are doing this.
I agree with you. I wonder, though, how much that actually filters down to the people on the ground, though. So I see this has always been the big issue of culture is we can put our values up on the wall and state that we apply for, you know, trust and integrity and honesty and doing the best for the customer. And that's the focus. But the problem is that what I am seeing in all this is that when you get down to the engineers and all the other people who are building our products, is they're under increased pressure. And I worry that the ethics down at that level are being sacrificed because do I call this or do I just get that ticket out the door because it's the next thing in the queue? We're saying yes more often to all of the work. Can you work on 7 projects at once? It's yes. You know, can you get this thing through? The whole thing about this invading into our home life. And so I think on some of the big issues as a community we've seen over the last year, the community rising up around things that perhaps have been bubbling under the surface for a while. But I also still worry that the pressure that we're putting on people is that when you actually come down to people who are actually doing the work down at the team level, I think we've still got a long way to go to allow people to feel safe, that whole psychological safety that we always talk about in the culture of teams. I'm not entirely sure is there as much as it should be, even in those organizations sometimes that are proclaiming that they're doing a good job of it.
I share your worry.
I'm seeing a huge amount of literature, discussion and dialogue about psychological safety and those kinds of things, Craig. And I'm seeing the implementation in the organizations 99% of the time fail to understand it and fail to deliver it. And I think that there's a real issue, and it's why I was mentioning these culture engagement polling tools and such like, is people are starting to pretend that that data is enough to understand whether they're doing the right thing, rather than creating relationships between leaders and their staff and really building the right kind of empathy and environment to really thrive. And I think leadership education is one of the big things that I think is starting to emerge into our innovators space. In fact, I think we even had something about it last time. I haven't got the graph right in front of me. What was the thing about leadership in there, Shane?
Systemic and leadership coaching, we were saying, yeah, was an innovator practice in last year.
Yeah, so I am seeing more organizations start to commit to actually thinking, how do I bring my leaders forward to enable psychological safety, to enable this idea of motivated, engaged people, rather than just relying on a once a year engagement poll or now a once a day engagement poll and pretending that the data is going to somehow fix something. So I think the next step I'm seeing is active, educated, researched education of our leaders. I'm seeing now all of the courses come out, and remote has triggered this as well, from Scrum Alliance and IC Agile and all of these groups where we're now seeing leadership courses, people development courses, which are really talking about how do you bring psychological safety to a life properly rather than just pretending that an engagement campaign every year will do the job. So I'm kind of hopeful, but I think it's really poor at the moment.
I agree, it needs to be developed further. And what I'm also seeing, and then we had some stories about that on InfoQ also, are leaders who are sharing how they are doing this in their organization, how they are working with the people, how they are coaching the people, how they're being vulnerable themselves about the mistakes that they made in there and why they are doing this. that they're already doing a shout out that this is important, and they are sharing their personal stories in there. And I think those kind of personal stories can also trigger other leaders to either share their stories and speak up as they are doing, or at least make them think about, hey, there's value in this kind of stuff, and daring to experiment with this.
So what about things like diversity and inclusion? How are we doing there? There's been a lot of, dare I say, lip service. How well are we doing?
It seems to be moving towards the inclusion part, which I think is a good development. There was a lot of focus initially on diversity, but just having people invited there, but not creating the party where the people want to be, then it's not going to be working out anyway. So I think that, in a sense, is a good development. But still, I think there's a lot of lip service there also. So how many companies are truly doing this?
I think that we're seeing a lot of great intent, the Black Lives Matter movement, and I guess just generally trying to figure out how we can enable interaction of a wider diversity of people now that we have remote access to the entire globe of people to be part of our organization has changed the way people are looking for people even now. But the issue that I think everyone's struggling with is it's not just a matter of hiring these people, just suddenly switching and saying, we're going to change our basic hiring model. We've got to also change our internal culture to allow them in and allow them to be treated as an equal in our organizations rather than having an antigen effect or an immune effect rejecting the person who's speaking out and saying something different. So we're going to have to change that. But we're also suddenly finding actually a lot of these people, we don't have an access mechanism to them. I mean, the lack of people with STEM skills in our industry has been something that's been on the table for decades now. And we still haven't solved it. And now we've got the problem of not only do we not have enough generally educated people for our industry, but also the full diversity of people that could be in that industry are definitely not there. But that's still a decade away to develop that, to bring it through schools, to change the culture in the country that we're trying to hire in. It's a much bigger, wider, systemic problem rather than just change your hiring process. This is not going to be an overnight fix. It's probably going to be on our curve for a long time because it's generational, national level, or international level, not just organizational level.
I think actually that remote learning is something that can help us here, because if we have to wait until these kind of things are brought into the curriculum of universities, it's going to take us a long time. But now with having much more course, have much more opportunities for remote learning, and also possibilities there for people to use that kind of learning to develop themselves who are not able to go to university. So I think the learning possibility, expansion of learning possibilities can help to drive this and can give a boost to this.
This is something which I'm seeing. In the last 2 years, I've worked with several reinterpretations, people disrupting the university paradigm, people still getting degree qualifications, still getting that high standard learning. The people coming in, there are a lot of people changing their lives. And that's where I'm seeing the diversity. Mothers, I'm seeing a miner currently. A miner is in someone who worked in coal mines in Western Australia, coming in to learn IT skills. And they're changing their lives. They're bringing this wide range of experiences, which I can see in a team, just changing the way we address problems. They're learning industry-relevant skills. They have shorter programs that are better fitted to their lives. They're able to come out and join that workforce. So I'm a bit more optimistic about the rate of change. A personal experience as someone who is of a non-European origin, I've seen across my life that distribution change a lot. I've seen the industry change from a few people who looked like me to many people who looked like me. Now, I don't know what that's worth. The gender balance has been slower to change. But, you know, through what I'm seeing in education, I think, and I'm optimistic, that that's going to be something that we see changing in the next few years. And the thing to remember is that going back to this fourth industrial revolution stuff, the rapid ramp up of technology, I think we're in that rapid ramp up. And we're seeing it in COVID. Things that would have taken a lot longer to change culturally previously, and I'm the optimistic, I want to see the bright, shiny future. But I think there is this rapid change. So education, we're making it more accessible. There's a lot more of it. These massively online classrooms, making education available globally. Yeah.
That's great to hear, Raph. I'm really excited to hear you say that. It's good that you're in the industry and seeing it. It's fantastic. I'm just worried that it's going to be a long slog and that people went on the boil very quickly and then felt to me like they came off the boil really quickly. And I hope we see an ongoing commitment.
I think the commitment will come out of necessity. So what I see with remote right now is remote is opening up market. There are places like remoteok.io. And you go there and you look at the roles out there and their teams globally looking for people globally. And to me, that's talking about international teams. You know, I was lucky to work in companies that were progressive, which intentionally sought international teams. But there were often, you know, people who'd had the opportunity to have that high-class education in their countries. Now, we have markets opening up where you can get the person in Poland, you can get the person in India, you can get the person in the US, wherever, working together. I mean, I'm sure if you looked at the demographics of the GitLabs and the GitHubs right now, you'll see that it's good talent worldwide. And I see that as democratizing. It's making our industry open to many. How we succeed? I don't know. I think personally that that async paradigm, that remote working paradigm might be something we see. And I don't know how that's going to result in cultural fit, how it's going to result in people over process. I don't know how that's going to work, how that balance is going to work. I think that's going to be one of the challenges.
I guess I've just seen recently, I've been working with an organization where they have been trying to grow their team quite significantly, and they've been trying to take on the digital transformation, but it wasn't fundamentally part of their culture at all when this whole COVID thing hit. And the result has been that they've brought in lots of excited new remote people with some diverse skills, and then the organization's immune system has kicked in and kicked them out just as quickly. And so I'm really hopeful that that's only going to be a single example and that there's more winners than losers out there. But it's still really, really challenging for organizations to actually shift their culture when it has become so locked in a particular pattern.
I think this ties in with what we were talking about earlier, the late majority, the early majority in this hybrid model where they're trying to figure the good remote, bad remotes. And I think there is going to be, as with anything, the trickle down. But I'm kind of optimistic that in the current time, given the current necessity, that that trickle down will be amplified. I've seen government departments thinking more progressively around things like DevOps, about how they do remotes. And having seen some government departments, that's quite revolutionary. So, yeah.
That's a nice segue, if we may. Craig, one of the points that you were making before we came on air was bringing some of these ideas of agility into government, and we're also seeing business agility we put into early adopters last year. Where is that at, and what's happening with agile in government?
There's been a slow movement towards agility in government for a number of years, so this isn't anything particularly new, but it's probably been more in pockets. We've seen the US, for example, I think just recently, you know, put out a 250-page report on essentially agility in government, which is kind of ironic in its own way, that sort of mandating of work practices. This digital-first thing led by the UK government and the gov.uk is something you're seeing spreading if you look around the world. Canada, Singapore, Australia, New Zealand all now have variations of that. But I think what's happened in the world over the last 12 months has started to do is that because governments particularly have now been, you know, having to prop up certain parts of economies, and is that this crunch, and we haven't seen this yet, but that money's got to come from somewhere. And sometimes I think the amount of waste that goes in that process is, and I lump large corporates into this process as well, but particularly governments, as they've been sort of propping these things up, what happens when that support stops? What happens when that funding stops? And what does that look like in the next, you know, 1, 3, 5, even 10 years when governments are looking that far forward? At the moment, they have to be on the front foot, and it's forced them down this path. But for a lot of them, they've been scrambling to do this. It's just been a lot of hard work by a lot of people, and you can't sustain that type of process. So whilst I agree there's lots of good things happening, that they're actually talking about DevOps and they're talking about these collaborative type efforts, it's only sort of scratching the surface that actually there's going to be a need. Because what I worry about is that financial implication in years to come is going to be this crunch. That the countries that are going to come out of this with strong economies are going to be those that in themselves start to embrace this culture internally.
Do you think there's a difference between what you're seeing governments take on in the way they're adopting agility and the way private enterprise did 10 years ago? Do you just see it as a delay of the same pattern? Because I guess when Shane asked about business agility, I definitely don't see the business arms of government bringing any agility in yet. It's all been still focused on the tech space and on the engineering space. And I think that large organizations are mirroring that pattern. Any thoughts?
So interestingly, what I've been seeing more of late is actually the opposite to that, is actually a flip where organizations, now, when I say this, it's not true business agility. I completely agree with you. There's a long way to go in actually that whole cycle time of idea to customer. There's a lot of things to do in that process. But what I'm seeing now is that almost the IT organization, particularly in large organizations, are so overloaded and they haven't been able to adapt these things. Like, how do they work on the 7 or 10 projects at once that the business is trying to run? And so I'm actually seeing a lot of push from the business side to go, we need to do this faster. And so they're picking up the practices, But actually, because the organizational culture and the organizational processes behind that don't support it, it's now actually pushing that back into the IT area that are now falling back into old ways of working. And so they'll now push back and go, okay, we can do that, but go and write me a document in order to tell me what you want, almost to stem the flow of what they're after. So this whole thing of actually working together closely. But what that's now doing is essentially pushing the entire IT department back into those old ways of working where it's, we'll delay the conversation, we'll delay those things, we'll do what we know in order to push you backwards. So again, the smart organizations, and I see this a lot in large corporates and government, but actually even in small organizations that are just trying to make sense of all this, is that we still treat IT as a silo. We still hear the business versus IT type of a thing until we actually start to think about those team topologies and break those things away, really that true product-centric model. A lot of organizations have been able to put a facade over the front of that to a certain extent as a project or as a small breakaway team over here. But actually, they're the big challenges is actually, no, we actually have to do this as our real culture.
So I'd like to then propose, Shane, that we put an item on our innovators or early adopters, which is true integration of business and tech and breaking that silo, not even two items collaborating, but integrating them together fully into service streams or however you want to describe the concept. And I think that is something I am starting to see the real innovators start to do well and put together. Like Craig said, it's one of the big barriers to overcome to get true agility.
I was with a government agency at the start of the year before the pandemic, and it was by no means an innovator or an early adopter, possibly early majority, late end of the late majority, and many, many outsourced projects. They were going through a thing where they actually recognized they wanted more product teams, they wanted more product centricity, they wanted to break down those silos. And the silos existed, the silos were a cause for a lot of the tension, and I think there was an awareness there. I was working with heads of the product team, heads of the project management team to see how they may untangle that. But even them having that conversation, having that drive, listening to alternate ways of working, recognizing the dysfunction was something I think is indicative of something moving to the left a bit more. When you're aware of the things that you don't know or the things that you're not doing well, maybe that's a sign that it has actually crept back a bit. So there's an awareness. I don't know, awareness isn't the same as doing because the doing wasn't happening.
Mm.
It's one big blocker that I still see if I'm looking at adopting agility in the government world in there. And that big blocker is that there's not really the safety in government to reflect and to learn from things that have gone wrong. And believe me, there's lots of opportunities to learn. And if I look at the Dutch IT system, Dutch government system, there's lots to learn. But I'm guessing this is worldwide an issue. So there's stuff to learn in there, but the basic process I still see, if they even start to learn, is they wait until the end of the project, 2 or 3 years, 4 or 5 years. And then when they investigate the project, what you see in there is that they're looking for who to blame. And you can't get this out of the government culture. It's always looking on, okay, somebody's got to take the blame in there because things have gone wrong. And I'm not sure how you can get the turnaround in this process, in this kind of mindset, because I think this is truly blocking any true agility if you look in the government. If they don't get into this culture like we want to learn from failure and we want to see a different way in there, we don't want to put the blame anywhere because that's not going to help us. And it's not going to change. I'm pretty pessimistic on this one. And you know, I'm a big optimist, but in this area, no, it scares me to death.
Ben, if I can pick up from you on the reflection, one of the things that we know you are well known for is retrospective practices. What is the state of practice? What is the state of art with that reflection, learning, and retrospectives today?
I think the state of art is that companies are getting better in collecting the data or getting better in generating insights, either by using different formats in their retrospectives. I think also partly by using more and more of the online tools, and that there are many tools. I see new retrospective tools popping up every 2-3 weeks, and I'm probably not seeing all of them. It's even growing faster than programming languages, probably. But if you look at really bringing it back to a shared learning and taking action, that's where still the big challenge is in retrospectives. We have the data, but getting people to agree on, okay, what do we learn from this? What is the thing that we're going to be doing differently like now? What's the thing that we're going to experiment with? And taking that to action in the team, that's where still the big struggle is in retrospectives. And I think one technique that can actually help in there is a kind of gamification, where you can create a setting where people can play to get a better understanding, to get this shared understanding. And once they start seeing the problem together, finding a solution is going to become a lot easier in there. So I'm hoping that that can make a difference in there.
There's one last topic I'd like us to explore together. We are in February 2021. It's almost exactly 20 years since the Agile Manifesto was written. There's a lot of other events going on around, but what is our reflection on 20 years of this Agile thing?
Well, one reflection that I would like to add is if I look back 20 years from now, when the first stuff started popping up around Agile, seeing the papers that Alistair Coburn was writing at the time about collaborative game and seeing how things were looking at short cycle delivery and learning and improvement in there, my first impression at that time was like, yeah, this is great stuff and this works. And I know it works because I've been doing it. But it's so at odds with what's the culture in companies or what's the current way that companies are being organized at. I don't think this stuff can work in most of the companies. If it could work in 20% of the companies, that would be nice. And maybe if you lift it up, then it might be interesting for about half of the companies, but the other half probably shouldn't even try it. And to my big surprise, almost every company has tried to adopt Agile, and unfortunately, many of them have failed. So I'm not sure if that proves my statement like we shouldn't try it, but I think this is not something that can become common. It's still a thing that really, if you want Agile to work, you really need a kind of culture, you really need a kind of mindset in there for stuff in there to take off. And most of the companies, unfortunately, don't have this. So why even bother to try it? There's so much failure in there. Then the question is, okay, and certainly a lot of those failures, by the way, are also caused by the way that these Agile initiatives have been done in companies. If you want to create self-organization and self-management to the company and you want to tell everybody how to do their work, that's not going to work out, right? So a lot of these Agile initiatives are done in a non-Agile way, which is already a cause for failure. But even then, I'm wondering, like, could this really succeed in the majority of companies?
I think that the manifesto people must truly be surprised that pretty much the entire world has tried this. And I think that we should be amazed that it's gone that far, where it's a common vocabulary in every organization on the planet, whether they've tried it or not. And most of them have tried it in some part, in somewhere. I think the thing that we possibly could have predicted is that if you put out something that's a concept, a mindset, a philosophy, something quite kind of amorphous, and then it's going to go in a million directions, and it has. And I think that the good news there is that some of those million directions are showing that they've got lifespan for the next 20 years. And yes, it's going to take long generational change times for everyone to grasp the concepts, and some people are going to go out of business, the blockbuster effect, but in a process and culture sense, people won't realize that they're missing the wave and should be up and surfing by now.
There was a Mary Poppendike quote that I used for a short period, you know, when you're repeating a quote, but it was along the lines of, you know, in any other industry, if something has been around for 20 years and it's still seen as modern and new, then there's a problem there. You're not having the growth. I worked on the Waterfront projects. I think many of us did in that era. And I've seen the projects which were canned, which went over budget, where you worked on software and it never got released, and which went majorly over any estimates where the requirements were wrong. Going through the journey of working with those teams which were trying to do Scrum and then going through Kanban, there's kind of like an evolution and seeing the DevOps team come up. And I think there are values there which persist. So like, if anyone asks me now, I'm like, forget the frameworks, look at the values and principles, because for me, they still hold hugely. Are we learning? Are we addressing the customer? Do we know what we're trying to solve here? Technical excellence isn't, you know, there for shiny. It's there because it helps us achieve a better product. How do we use those principles to govern our approach? And it becomes a lot more contextual. But I think there is still a lot, the early majority, the late majority, Scrum is the way to go. People trying to hold on to the safe practices. Here's the framework. I myself remember trying to appease an architect at one stage by going into Dad and studying Dad and thinking, this is a nice compromise. But at the end of it, you realize you were just putting lots of constraints around a team's evolution. And I think the future is lean. It's moving. It's measuring. It's being empirical. It's improving continuously, is my take on it. It's the DevOps. It's the DevSecOps. It's shifting left. It's seeing the whole value chain. It's optimizing flow. So I think that approach has gone past the early adopters, perhaps to some parts of the early majority. Because I hear, we don't want to do Scrum. And then you think, oh God, are you going to do Waterfall? But actually, when you hear the language of people doing their own ad hoc thing, sometimes you pick up those lean principles in there. They're actually trying to move quickly. They're trying to use design thinking. They're trying to use other approaches, which are very same. One thing I love doing with my students is putting the design thinking graph up, the agile principles. I think I use modern agile. I put out the figure of eight, the DevOps lifecycle. There's a lean UX series of things. And they're all the same, right? They're about delivering value, optimizing the whole, continuously improving, learning, having learning feedback loops. I think there's an essence there. You know, agile as a term was great. It flipped our minds and the tools we can pick and choose from.
I think the thing is, if you look at the 12th principle of agility, it's around continuous improvement. And so to me, I think they succinctly put in words, whilst we can debate some of those things, and there's a few things that are a little bit dated and some omissions, but for the most part, that's the problem that we need to solve. And the 12th principle says we need to continuously improve. And so the agile that I was doing 20 years ago, back in the early days when the only book I had was Extreme Programming Explained and a couple of papers I was dragging off this thing that was called the internet that I hit on a 56K modem. Now, 20 years later, if you think about where we are, we needed something different. And it's the thing we can all balance back to. And yes, I think we can be negative and look at things and go, yeah, things aren't where they need to be. But that's also continuous improvement. And that hopefully is going to push us harder in the next 20 to build the better frameworks or to build the better approaches. You know, we built DevOps because we all of a sudden went, we've got a cloud and we need to do something. And that's grown. And look at how where that's grown in 10 years. You know, it didn't exist 10 years ago. I think when we look at it at a much wider scale, do we have a lot to do? Yes, we've got wicked problems to solve. And that's the call to action I have for us and our community is we now need to rally around those wicked problems, solve the business agility that we were talking about before, solve these issues. Those things are open on the table for someone to come up with real solutions to, because if we're failing, it's just giving us that feedback to go, okay, this isn't as easy as we thought and we need to look forward. So I'm optimistic for the future. I think we've shown that is a little slower than we thought. Well, I mean, agility, you know, try going faster. Yeah, I'd like it to be a bit faster, but we have moved a long way in 20 years.
And I think that's a great note for us to end on. We've moved a long way in 20 years. There's a long way to go. And the reflection, learning, and adapting. And if there's anything that we as the culture and methods crew at InfoQ do try and do is provide people with ideas to reflect and learn and adapt from. So gentlemen, thank you very much for your time. It's been an absolute pleasure.